All right. All right, well, we're going to continue in a spirit of worship. We're going to look at the Word of God, and we've been in a long series called Shaping. If you're new this morning and you want to know the whole picture, you can get a book, a little booklet called Shaping at the front desk. But we are in the section of just celebrating our neediness before Christ, and that He Himself was needy before His Father, which is not the culture that we're in. We're in a culture of self-sufficiency, and so it's countercultural. But as we've sung and offered our offerings and celebrated our testimonies, we're beginning to get a picture of what that really looks like. And today's command is a really challenging one, because it comes from the book of Revelation, and Jesus is commanding us to hold on to what we have until He returns. To hold on. And this is obviously a picture of dependency. To hold on to Him, to hold on to His Word, to hold on to one another, to encourage one another. So this command is coming out of Revelation chapter 2. So you can turn there, but we're going to have it on the screen. And this book was written in the last decade or so of the first century. It is a book revealing the risen Christ. And so this is a very important part of Scripture to get our minds wrapped around. We're actually going to be in it for a couple of weeks to get our minds wrapped around that this is the risen Christ speaking. This is the one who's back in heaven after His death on the cross, His rising from the grave to pay the penalty of our sins, to bring in the new creation, to bring in the Holy Spirit. All the things that Jesus did while He was on earth, He ascends into heaven. And this letter, this part of the Bible is Jesus speaking as the risen Christ, as the royal crowned King of the universe. So if you're able, go ahead and stand. And we're going to honor God's word by reading it out loud. The command is in verse 25, but I'm going to take the whole context, which is a letter that Jesus is dictating to the Apostle John, to the church in a city called Thyatira. Thyatira is one of the seven cities that gets a letter from Jesus in the book of Revelation. And it's seven cities on the postal route in the ancient province of Asia, modern-day Turkey. So this is to the church in Thyatira. So let's read it. To the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did at first. Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols. I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I will cast her on a bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely, unless they repent of her ways. I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am He who searches hearts and minds, and I will repay each of you according to your deeds. Now I say to the rest of you in Thyatira, to you who do not hold to her teaching and have not learned Satan's so-called deep secrets, I will not impose any other burden on you. Only hold on to what you have until I come. To him who overcomes and does my will to the end, I will give authority over the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He will dash them to pieces like pottery. Just as I have received authority from my Father, I will also give him the morning star. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Thank you for honoring the Word of God. You can be seated. So here now we have a very different Jesus than the nice, you know, bland, vanilla, everything is fine all the time Jesus that people take little snippets out of the Gospels where he's healing people or he's encouraging someone. Yes, he does all those things. He has amazing compassion. Yes, he has an amazing desire to care for people. Yes, he's a great shepherd of the sheep and he is patient and all those things. But he is also the King of the universe, who embodies all of the attributes of God, including the wrath of God, including the massive distaste for evil of God, including those that would speak as a false prophet or a false teacher in his name. And he will put them on a bed of suffering. He will kill their children. Yes, this is Jesus speaking. We need to have the whole picture of Jesus, because when he returns, he came first as a suffering servant, but when he returns, he will be the warrior king, and he will set everything straight. Now, this is important to the church. This is why this is in the Bible. This is important to the church to understand that Jesus is still in the business of judging the churches and correcting the churches and encouraging the churches. This is not something he stopped doing after the book of Revelation. He is passionate about his church. It's his wife. He is passionate about his bride. And so this scripture is incredibly relevant, because in that day in Asia, the world was falling apart. Sexual immorality everywhere. People teaching that, you know, you can go and do X, Y, and Z with somebody, and as long as you don't have intercourse, it's okay. Or you can do this and that, and it's okay. God will forgive you. It's fine. Do what you like. This is the teaching of Jezebel. This is manipulative teaching. This is incorrect teaching. This is the kind of teaching that leads people away from salvation, leads people away from the truth, leads people away from Jesus. So Jesus speaks to this church, and I love how he starts with, "You guys are awesome. You're persevering. You're loving. You're giving. You're hanging in there. You're serving the poor. You're doing more than you did at the beginning." That could be a message to Mariemont Church. There are just so many things, and yet in every church, in every heart, there's sin. And in every church, there's problems. Welcome to a sinful, fallen world. Now, hopefully, we have taken out the false teachers. Hopefully, we have been careful to watch what is said from here, or what is said in Bible studies, and whatever. But nevertheless, there are voices out there, on television, in the media, in what I would even describe as televangelist circles, or in the political realm, there are voices saying this is fine. There are Supreme Court judges saying this is okay. This is legal. And we are in the very same place today. The relevancy of this letter, the relevancy of Scripture has never been higher. Financial chaos, refugee chaos in Europe and a lot of parts of the world. We see political chaos. We see arms deals and nuclear instability in our world. We see all kinds of stuff in the news, and that is exactly what is going on around this church. The world seems to be crumbling off of its foundations, its biblical foundations, the way God would have it. And that is really why David wrote Psalm 11. He said, "What, when the foundations are crumbling, what can the righteous do?" And in verse 4, he answers the question, "God is reigning on high." He is still judging. He's still speaking to the church. The Spirit of God is still speaking to the church. And we are receiving this command from Jesus today as fresh as it was at the end of the first century. Hold on to what you have. In the midst of chaos, in the midst of this craziness, hold on to what you have. And I, Jesus, will help you overcome. If you trust me, if you've asked me for forgiveness of your sin by my blood, if you're following me, if you're in that pursuit of Jesus, you are saved. and he speaks to the church. You heard him speak to Ernie's wife. You heard him speak over here. He speaks. He's speaking to the church. And today he's telling us to hold on. When all that stuff is crumbling around us, hold on. Hold on to what? Hold on, first and foremost, to me. Hold on to Jesus. Hold on to the Father. Hold on to the Holy Spirit. Hold on to the Word of God. Hold on to your spouse. You're struggling in your marriage. You are looking for an awakening in your marriage. Pray for your spouse. Pray that you would love them like Jesus loves them. Pray, pray, pray. Hold on. Hold on to one another. If someone in this body is hurting, someone in this body is feeling rejected, someone in this body is struggling through a loss of a job or a need for a new job, then we need to be also coming alongside, making meals, praying. All of our time, talent, and treasure is available to this church. All of my time and talent and treasure is available to this church as needed, because we are one family. Hold on. Hold on. That is super relevant to us today. Now, where does this idea of holding on come from? In the Old Testament, it's used in several different places, and I've just picked five here. It appears first in Genesis 2:24, where it says the man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. That word there, united, translated sometimes cleave to his wife, also could be translated hold fast to his wife. That's the first use of that in Scripture. And then we have it in Deuteronomy. Hold fast to him, to the Lord your God. Hold fast to him. In the book of Psalms, we have in Psalm 119, I hold fast to your statutes, O Lord. Do not let me be put to shame. Holding fast to the word of God. Ruth, when the other widow of the brother kissed Naomi goodbye, Ruth clung to her. Ruth stayed and clung to her. Same word. And in Proverbs, hold on to instruction. Do not let it go. Guard it well, for it is your life. Holding on to the person of Christ, holding on to the Word of God, holding on to each other. Those are the meanings in the Old Testament. This is what Jesus was speaking about. So how do we apply this? Well, we apply it in all of our lives right now. What are we struggling with? What are we asking God for? Are we looking into those challenges we're facing? These seemingly insurmountable odds, college bills, marital trouble, trouble in our extended family, so-and-so can't get a job, needs a loan, whatever it might be. We all have got tugs on us for relationships that are struggling and broken, for problems, you know, in our work, for all those things. And then we layer on top of that all the things going on around us in our economy, in our geopolitical situation, and we say, hold on. Hold on. God is simply speaking to us about persevering. You know, this promise that he comes with at the end of the letter is that to all of those who overcome, and his specific word there, overcome, that's to all of us who have victory. Is another translation, overcoming. We are destined to be overcomers. We are destined to walk through this life and to overcome the evil and all the difficulties around us because Jesus himself has overcome. And so when we overcome, he is going to give us a place on his throne. I don't know how that works, but I know it's true. And we are going to judge the nations. And we're going to break Psalm 2, verses 8 and 9, where he is going to rule with an iron scepter and he's going to smash evil like a piece of pottery. And we're going to be part of that. Every single wrong that's ever been done to us will be vindicated. Every single thing wrong on planet Earth will be vindicated. Every sin we've committed will be forgiven if we're trusting Christ. And so this is the picture of like this total setting of things right at the end. That's our hope. And then finally, he says, I will give them the morning star. What is he talking about? Well, in Revelation 22, verse 16, Jesus says, I am the bright morning star. In 2 Peter 1:19, it says, when the morning star rises in your hearts. You see, we have a faith that is in the one who's indestructible. We have a faith, and it says that that faith, that person of Jesus is in us. It's in us. He is in us. Did you experience that in worship? He was present. He was present. And so that's the morning star rising in our hearts. So in other words, at the end, the reward we're going to get is Jesus himself. Jesus is the morning star. And he says, I will give you the morning star. He's saying, I will give you myself. You will be fully embraced in my presence, in my power, in my perfection. That is what happens to the overcomers. So you can overcome battles in education, battles in your athletics, battles in your relationships that have been broken. You can forgive people around you. You can seek restoration. You can pray for your spouse. You can hold on to your spouse. You can encourage other married couples to hold on, to see their spouse the way Jesus sees their spouse. Now, I tried to come up with a picture of overcoming, and the best example that popped into my mind this past week was the true story of Rudy Rudiger, who had a dream from a Pennsylvania steel town to play football for Notre Dame. Now, this isn't a religious story, it's not a Bible story, but it's a wonderful illustration of overcoming, because this guy told his dream, and his dad said he was a dummy and would never make it. He's this tall, by the way. His dad said he'd never make it. His brother said he'd never make it. He was ridiculed all the time. He went over there. He didn't even have good enough grades to get into Notre Dame, so he went to a college next door for a year to get good enough grades so he could even get in. He finally gets into Notre Dame. He goes to the football coach. The football coach, you know, he just badgers him, really badgers him, and he finally gets on the football team on the practice squad. And then for the next 4 years, they pummel him on the practice squad. He gets tackled and bruised and busted and floored and flattened, and he keeps getting up. He keeps getting up. And finally, in his senior year, after going through all the classwork, all the hard work, paying off, you know, working part-time, sleeping in the caretaker's office underneath the football stadium, he finally gets to his senior year, and he doesn't get to dress a single football game. And finally, on the week before the last football game of the regular season, the team players came into the coach's office and put their jerseys on the coach's desk. And they all of them said, we want Rudy to play in place of me, coach. So finally, the coach relents. The coach lets Rudy play, lets Rudy dress for the final game. Now we're in the fourth quarter of the final game, the very last minute, and Notre Dame is killing it. They're beating the other team. And the players start yelling, Rudy, Rudy, Rudy. Finally, this Rudy thing spreads into the whole crowd. So here's the rest of the story. Now, I know that's just a football movie, and it's a true story. No one has been carried off the field at Notre Dame since that took place in 1975. But how do I want to connect the dots to when Jesus says we're going to overcome. Imagine his 4 years of just getting pounded and pulverized and ridiculed. Imagine all the hard work he put in. Imagine that that's your life. Imagine that as you follow Christ, as you hold on to him, imagine that day in the great stadium, after Jesus returns, and he enables you to make that final tackle to defeat that final enemy, Satan himself. And then he lifts you up on his shoulders and he says, well done, good and faithful servant. You have overcome. Now I want you to feel what that's going to feel like. And we can only come to a very rough approximation of what that feels like. But I want you to feel what that feels like, because that is our destiny in Christ. That is our destiny in Christ, to overcome. To overcome. And the New Testament writers would tease that out, and they would take this hold on idea and they would put it in. You could see it all through the New Testament. I've given you three selections. Acts 2:24, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on Jesus. Hold on to the good. Avoid every kind of evil. And then in Hebrews 3:6, and we are his house, living stones, if we hold on to our courage and the hope of which we boast. This is our calling, is to hold on, to trust. Some of you are in impossible situations right now. Some of you are struggling in many important areas. The message of Jesus today is to hold on. Hold on to that hope that one day you'll be carried in the stadium on his shoulders. You'll be on the throne with him. Carry that hope. So let me just finish this morning. I want to just have you close your eyes. I'm going to lead us in a time of prayer, and then we're going to close with a video. By the way, just on this whole point of holding on and trusting God, if you have not seen the movie War Room, I encourage you, if you want to be encouraged to hold on to God in prayer, then that's a great film. So, War Room. But Father, as we come to the close now, we just want to, again, make space in this place for you. We want to open our hearts to you. For those of us who have never trusted Christ with all of our life, with our sin, who have never asked forgiveness for our rebellion and our sin, that forgiveness is available right now in this time, in this place. That you would ask God to forgive you, and that you would walk with Jesus, follow him, hold on to him, and tell somebody here, and we'll pray with you. Or if you're struggling and you want more faith and more of God and a better prayer life and hearing his voice more often, you ask him for that now in this time, in this place. He hears your cry. And for those of you who just need God to come along and lift you over this obstacle, will you ask for that now? He is worth holding on to, because he has been the only one that death couldn't hold on to. He's worth holding on to because his love stretches so far and so wide and so deep and so long that he can fill your every need right now. So, Father, hear the prayers of your people. We're needy before you today, Lord. Thank you for hearing our cries, Lord. In Jesus' name. Let's watch this video to close.
resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you I run.
We all stand. So, church, I just bless you this week to let go of the things that aren't of God and to hold on. Hold on to Jesus. Hold on to His Word. Hold on to one another. Do that in the power of the Holy Spirit. I bless you to go and have a fantastic week of holding on. Amen.